Hello, everyone. My name is Ron Payne. I'm president of the Otter Creek Audubon Society. Happy to be doing our inaugural cabin fever lecture of the year. We're going to have two more after this. In February, we're having Hank Case talk about birds of Taiwan. And then in March, we're having someone come to talk about an organization called Wild Utah. It's going to be wildlife and public lands, protecting public lands in Utah. So a couple interesting ones we got coming up. Mm-hmm. Another event we got coming up is this Saturday is our monthly wildlife walk at Audubon Park and the herd grassland. That's 8 a.m. at the park. We've got our big board out. We've got a bunch of materials. If you're not a member, we'd love to have you be a member. We've got a jar over there for donations if you feel like it. So that's all the business, I think. So this is actually kind of interesting because this is the 10th year that we're doing Cabin Fever Lecture Series. And 10 years ago, our first one ever was from Vermont Fish and Wildlife, Doug Blodgett, talking about mountain lions and whether or not they're in Vermont, and some study he did out west learning about mountain lions. So it's a nicer little bookend situation here, because tonight we've got Chris Bernier, also from Vermont Fish and Wildlife. He's a wildlife biologist and the fur bearer project leader for Vermont Fish and Wildlife, and he's going to be talking about another big cat, the Canada Lynx. So everyone, Chris Bernier.
Thank you. Thanks. So before we get into things, let me just do a sound check. Is everyone hear me okay?
Yeah.
Too loud? I don't want to overpower you. All right. So a little bit of background on myself as we get started here, just so you know who I am. I hail from Maine and found myself in Vermont in 1994, working with Vermont Fish and Wildlife. I've been here since then, mostly as a specialist out of the Springfield District. Excuse me. A specialist is a fancy title for a technician, essentially, and in that capacity I did all of the district field work for Fisheries and Wildlife Division. And one of the projects that I worked a lot on was the bobcat study that took place here in the Champlain Valley that I suspect many of you probably are familiar with. And I, during that time, developed quite a taste for the greater Middlebury-Champlain Valley area, and it's good to be back. Albeit a little bit of a dreary night, but still a beautiful place. And the reason why I bring up, well, first, let me go back a little bit. So in 2012, I stepped into the role of FERBA project leader and have been in that capacity since. And so the FERBA project, so that you understand what I'm talking about here, deals with a whole host, a whole suite of species that are classified, a legal classification, as fur bearers, those species which were either historically or contemporarily harvested primarily for their fur. There are 17 of them in the state, ranging from the weasel to the wolf. And I'm not suggesting that there are wolves here per se, but we have our own rendition of wolves, the coy wolf, as you've probably heard a lot about lately. But as you can imagine, having 17 species, you know, 13 of which have trapping seasons for them, 6 of which have hunting seasons for them, 4 of them are listed, either state or federally listed, meaning endangered or threatened, such as the lynx, which we'll talk about. You can only imagine the breadth of issues that arise from that suite of species. Some of them are known to cause lots of problems for humans, such as beaver, albeit an incredible ecological resource for all of us. They do cause problems. There are social issues for these species, there's political issues, legal issues, ecological issues. To say that it is overwhelming is a serious understatement. It is quite overwhelming to try to balance all of those things. And so I say that to preface the fact that, you know, I cannot, by nature of that position, be an expert on every one of these species. You know, it's just too much. But I will say that the Canada lynx is one species that I spend definitely a disproportionate amount of my time dealing with, and I will say quietly, it's my favorite. It's the best one, actually. It's a very cool species. So that's the background there, and we'll dive in. And I will say, well, we have a relatively small group here that I'll start at a couple points when I want to cover some just basic biology characteristics, then I want to move into a little bit of history of the species here in the state and to a lesser degree across the country. And then end with our current management strategies for the species. So in between those, I'll open it up for questions. But if you have a burning question about something I've said, please feel free to interrupt me too. This is a nice small crew, so we have that ability to do that. So we'll get right into it. We'll get down to the nuts and bolts. Who is this animal we're talking about? I'm here tonight to talk about snowshoe hare. I'm going to spend a fair amount of time going through some of the key distinguishing characteristics between bobcat and lynx. And there's a very specific reason for that. These animals are close cousins of each other. So the fossil records would indicate that during the Pleistocene, when the Bering land bridge was open, there was an invasion of Asian lynx across the land bridge into North America. And that invasion had to occupy the North American continent below the glaciers, right? And so then 20,000 years later, there was a second invasion of the Asian lynx. And what it found when it got here was that the first invasion, now 20,000 years established, had changed, it evolved, and had occupied all of the area south of the glaciers. And so this new invasion had to squeeze its way in between the glaciers and what's now the bobcat. So the second invasion ultimately became the lynx, which is why it's a northern animal, because it's always been segregated to the north.
Are you sure there isn't crossing now?
Oh, there's definitely hybridization between the two, yeah. Yep, there's no doubt about it. That's been documented fairly, not regularly, but it's been documented across the range where the two species coexist. So more importantly, when you bring it to Middlebury, Vermont, and the Champlain Valley in general, this is a bobcat haven. There are lots and lots of bobcats in the Champlain Valley. It's ripe habitat for bobcats. You've got the western slopes of the Green Mountains, which provide excellent habitat. You've got a mix of ag land interspersed with some forest and wetlands, beautiful bobcat habitat. And so people see bobcats. And you'll hear a lot about lynx, and so I get a lot of sightings from the Champlain Valley, people thinking that they're seeing lynx, when in fact, probably it's a bobcat. And this will make more sense as we go through. But I am going to spend some time to give you all those key distinguishing characteristics so you can go forth and inform the rest of the public here on, no, that was probably a bobcat, and here's why. So you can see by the weight ranges here that they are similar in size, but when you average the sexes together for each of the species, lynx are actually pound for pound a little bit lighter than a bobcat. They appear to be bigger. As you can see, they're longer, and they're actually a little bit taller as well. And here, you've got some pictures of both of them. Interestingly, the picture of the bobcat is a local picture from Weybridge, taken by a woman on her property, and a fabulous picture, I might add. I don't know where the lynx picture came from, but it's a beauty. So you can see, one of the key features here are the length of the legs, and you can see they are exaggerated in length on the lynx. And they're more so exaggerated in the rear than the front. So they actually have a stooped or jacked appearance. And that, you can actually see how the lynx's head is down low, and the back is flat, right across almost to the top of its head. That's very characteristic of a lynx. Bobcat, their legs are relatively similar in length, and they don't have that stooped appearance. One of the key things that people commonly will assert when they have a sighting is that it had ear tufts, so therefore it had to be a lynx. And while lynx certainly have ear tufts, as you can see, very prominent, in fact. Bobcat will also have ear tufts. It's not uncommon for particularly a mature male to have a pretty distinguished ear tuft. But overall, the lynx ear tuft is definitely more pronounced, as much as 2 inches long. And it's a pretty fabulous feature, I think. The other thing would be their general pelage, or their coat, their pelts. The differences between the two are subtle. And again, when we talk about these things, you have to talk in a general nature, because there's a lot of variety in colors. But generally speaking, lynx tend to be much more gray and not mottled, not spotted like the bobcat. And actually, I have an example of both to pass around. And I'm not going to tell you which is which. I think you'll readily figure it out. But you can see when you handle these, note the fur quality as well. And look at the spots on the underside and the ear tufts. They're all there. And the feet. So looking up here, I'm going to give it away a little bit, but you can see here that the bobcat, particularly on its underparts, on its belly, is very spotted, black spotted on a white background. The lynx, not so much. It's more bland in appearance. I hate to call them bland, but you get my point. The other thing that people commonly hone in on when they have a sighting is the rear end of the animal, and that's because that's usually all you get to see. And there are some very key differences between these two, and this is uniform for the species, so there's not a lot of variety here. The bobcat typically holds its tail curved up, not always, but typically, and it's white on the underside. And if a lot of bow hunters and turkey hunters who tend to be very, very camouflaged by the nature of those pursuits, they see a lot of bobcats here and across their range, of course. And they commonly will say, oh yeah, it was definitely a bobcat. It had that white flash. And as the cat walks, it will twitch that tail, and it actually flashes. The lynx, on the other hand, has a black tip tail, and it usually hangs down like that. Not always, but usually. This is a little bit closer look, bobcat being on the right here, of course, and lynx on the left. You can see the top view is the top of the tail. They both look black on top, but underneath, the bobcat is clearly much whiter, or it is stark white. So something to look at when you're seeing, you get that fleeting second, try to get a glimpse of that rear end and that tail, because that's a key distinguishing feature. And then I think my favorite distinguishing characteristic of the lynx are its feet. And I have to say, these things are awesome. They are awesome. Their feet are massive. And I'll point out a few things here before we take a closer look at the feet. But one of the things that's interesting to note here, can people see the that laser beam there? You see, this is the heel of the lynx here, and this is the heel of the bobcat right there. And you can see that the lynx actually walks much more lower on its heel. It's not quite plantigrade, but meaning walking on its heels like humans, but very close. I think you'll figure out why that's the case here in a minute. But also they have these massive, massive feet, easily twice the size of a bobcat foot, even on the juveniles. I mean, the juveniles are really funny to watch because they're all foot with a little tuft of cat up above. But you can see here, this is actually a picture from the Mohegan Basin in 2012 that I took up there when we were doing some tracking. And you can see right here this almost like an ice cream cone shape. That's the heel coming down and almost registering. And you can see with the bobcat that it does not do that. The bobcat comes straight down in a very definitive, defined pads. And the other thing about the lynx paw is that it's very furry. If you take a moment to look, you have to be careful. There are claws in these pelts still. But if you poke around in there, but you'll see that their pads are very furred. And so they don't leave a very distinct pad, not as much with the bobcat, or less distinct than the bobcat. So we move on a little bit. We'll come back to some differences between bobcat and lynx, but talking more generally about where they exist, they exist all across North America, from really just the northern tier of the United States north to just south of the tundra. The historic range almost certainly came down a little bit further into the United States, and there's northern tier states, but not dramatically so. Probably further down the Rocky Mountains, the Continental Divide, maybe a touch down the Appalachian spine a bit as well. But it's always been relegated to that really northern part of the continent. And you can see this is a current map. You know, Vermont, of course, we are right on the edge, and that's pretty accurate as far as we can tell. So this is an animal of the boreal forest. That's that spruce fir. I mean, that's basically all it is, just miles upon miles upon miles of spruce fir. They do not really get into the tundra too much unless there's some reason for them to do so, which we will touch on in a bit. And they generally don't wander too far south out of the boreal forest. They will occupy the transitional zone between boreal and the more temperate forest further south.
Except in Idaho.
Yeah, there are places, again, when we talk about this, these things, you have to talk in general, right? There are exceptions all the time. But they do find their way down the Continental Divide there quite a ways. And actually, did anyone see the video? I think it was in Colorado. Recently of a lynx that stumbled out onto a ski trail.
I heard of that.
It's awesome. I mean, you could easily find it by Googling, you know, lynx on ski trail. I'm sure it would be the first hit. It's fascinating. This adult just wandered out onto the trail, and there's piles of people all around it taking pictures, videoing. You can only imagine. It was a celebrity, and it just kind of looked at everybody and wandered right through, kept on going. The one thing that I wanted to make clear from this is that they are a habitat specialist, meaning that they really occupy and utilize only one distinct habitat type. On the other hand, you look at bobcat, they're just the opposite. They are perhaps one of the most wide-ranging land mammals of North America, and they occupy essentially every habitat that the continent has to offer except for the boreal forest and, of course, the tundra. You'll have them in desert, you'll have them in high elevation, you'll have them in prairies, you'll have them in the forest, the wetlands, all over.
Do you know if traditionally they were in the Great Lakes area that they're now absent from?
I think they were, actually, yeah. And I think this is a distinct result of human manipulations of the landscape there, because it doesn't make sense otherwise.
That was my question.
Yeah.
Why they were
asking. Yeah. It's the donut hole. Has anyone driven through there?
And is that from Agricultural Valley in California?
Why?
Right here, yeah.
Yep.
Those are the ecological limitations, right? They are a very habitat generalist species, but there are still limitations, and humans are the ones that sometimes are driving those limitations. This is, I think, one of the coolest things, too, about lynx, is that they are absolutely dependent on snowshoe hare. They have a very distinct relationship with snowshoe hare, which we're gonna dive into. But before I do that, can everyone see the bottom there? I don't know if you can read that. I can read it for you. So this is by Ernest Thompson Seton, who's one of Vermont's early natural historians. In his notes, he wrote, "Of all the northern creatures, none are more dependent on rabbits than is the Canada lynx. It lives on rabbits, follows the rabbits, thinks rabbits, tastes like rabbits, increases with them on their failure, dies of starvation in the unrabbited woods." Yeah.
So, we're probably going to have a lot more bobcats.
Because of the
rabbits everywhere.
Through the roof, yeah. Absolutely. It is important to note that Ernest's use of the term rabbits is inclusive of snowshoe hare, because lynx actually don't utilize cottontails, not to the degree that they rely on snowshoe hare. And so when you look at the range of snowshoe hare here on the right compared to lynx on the left, there's the answer. I mean, they only exist where snowshoe hare are abundant. Yeah.
So why are they absent in Newfoundland? Because
neither lynx nor bobcat are shown as existing in there.
I think you're starting to get beyond that habitat quality, that the you're getting out of the boreal and transitioning into, you're talking about up here.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're getting into that.
Lynx nor bobcat were evident in Newfoundland, so.
Yeah, and I think it's driven by the habitat that's there. You're transitioning into those tundra landscapes, which doesn't support either. So a few things to point out to drive home that relationship is that when they rely on hair, it's certain densities of hair. And the reason why I'm going to stress this is because it's important when we talk about lynx in Vermont. So for a population of lynx to thrive, and this is based on reams of research across their range, on average you're talking about 0.4 hairs per acre is what is required for a lynx population to thrive. They can certainly survive on less. In fact, when you get down to 0.2, that's when things start to change, where the lynx start, their reproductive rates start to plummet from 6 down to 0. They start dispersing, and they do some prey switching to other small mammals, including rabbits, where they might be available. But essentially, if that hair population drops down below 0.2, you're not going to have lynx there. There's just not enough to support them. And that's key. That's a key point for our later conversation here. And again, not to harp on it, but I find this kind of funny. This is actually excerpted from one of my textbooks when I was back in school, and I won't tell you the date, but a long time ago now, and it's still in the textbooks today. It is the classic predator-prey relationship. And this was compiled from the Hudson's Bay fur harvest records, which are extensive, as you might imagine, and we're talking thousands and thousands and thousands of animals here. And some folks back in the 1940s stumbled onto this relationship, and they started graphing and plotting, and like, wow, check that out. And there began the study of predator-prey relationships. And so there are a variety of theories, some pretty well-founded, others not so much, of what drives that relationship. Some say that it's not necessarily the lynx that is driving the relationship insofar as eating all the hair to the point where they drop off. They say that it's actually the hair population rises to a point where they impact their own habitat, hair habitat, and then their numbers start to dwindle, and then the lynx numbers follow. So it's not set in stone, but that's, you get the point. Pretty definitive relationship between the two. So lynx are solitary, unsociable animals. Boy, that does not paint them in a very pretty picture, does it? I don't know if they're unsociable, but the point is that they are largely a solitary animal. And what I find interesting, unlike a lot of other mammals, the males actually allow for overlap of home ranges. Not extensive, but they will allow for some of their home ranges to overlap, whereas the females are exclusive. So they maintain very definitive home range boundaries. But you can see the home range sizes here. They range from 24 square miles to 58 square miles. That's for males. Females are about half that size. And this is the range in the core of their habitat. When you get into the southern periphery of their habitat, which is where we are in Vermont, their ranges increase, presumably because they have to have access to that much more hair, because our densities are lower here, our hair densities, in order to subsist. So here in Vermont, I mean, we have not done any telemetry studies on lynx in Vermont, because we don't have enough of them to study, if that makes sense. But based on research that's been done in Maine and other places across their range in the southern periphery of the range, we would guess that a lynx in Vermont would be maintaining a home range of probably upwards of even maybe 80, possibly even 90 square miles, which is huge. I don't know how this one ended up in here because it's kind of out of context with the other bullets, but well, I know why it ends up in here because it gives me a chance to tell a story. So back in 98, I had an opportunity to participate in a 12-year-long research project in northern Maine in core lynx habitat, where there are plenty of lynx. And it was, like I said, a 12-year study. They had, I think it was in the order of 80 to 90 lynx collared, not through the duration, but individually through that time. And I got to participate in what they called the diary building days for lynx. So the way it worked is that they flew the study area. This is northern Maine, right on the Canadian border, deep, deep north. There's a lot of stories I could tell about getting there and surviving the trip to this part of the state in February on logging roads with big, big, big trucks that can't stop. I'll leave it there. But they flew the study area first thing in the morning, located all of the study animals with the collars on, the GPS collars. And then each of the technicians, as I was at that point, were assigned a particular lynx. And so we got on to our trucks and we drove as far as we could, going to that point where the lynx was that morning. We pulled out a snowmobiled as far as we could, got on our snowshoes, and then hiked into that point that we were given that morning, where that animal was just a mere 45 minutes, an hour earlier. Locate the track, and then backtrack it. So we didn't push it around. We backtracked the animals with GPS units, logging everywhere we walked, and logging everything that we could identify as far as their behavior based on their tracks. Where did they urinate, where did they defecate, where did they rest, where did they chase something, where they ate something, so on and so forth. And we followed, our instruction was to follow that track all the way back to the point where it disappeared in the previous snowstorm, which in this case was 36 hours previous. So it's a 36-hour diary of each of those study animals. And they did this multiple times. And they were also running a test of a survey methodology. So there's a whole other crew that are running around with snowmobiles, snowmobiling all this massive network of logging roads, and they're trying to intercept lynx tracks. That's a little bit more than I need to go into, but it was a crazy scene, to say the least. And what I'm trying to get at here is that while I was following my lynx, I mean, it was an awesome opportunity to learn about the behaviors of these animals. And the one thing that struck me the most, well, there's two things. One thing is that where it could walk on the surface of the no exaggeration 3 to 4 feet of powder, it could barely, it was leaving a track, but maybe this deep. And I'm up here with snowshoes wallowing in this spruce fir regeneration, trying to follow the animal. That was impressive. But the other thing was that it's an animal of the eyes, almost exclusively. You look at its skull compared to a coyote. This is where all the olfactory senses are in animals. I mean, look at this. This animal, the coyote, may not be able to see you, but it knows you are there, and it probably knew you were there a mile away. The lynx, on the other hand, may not smell you until it's right on top of you, but it's going to see you if you even twitch or if you don't have perfect camouflage. And the way I could determine that from the tracks was that it would come to a snowshoe hare trail, and snowshoe hares were lay down trails where they would run back and forth, and it would just sit. And you could tell that it had sat for a lengthy period of time in wait and watching, and was just patient and watching. And as soon as a hare would come by, it would just bound out in powder snow and chase down a snowshoe hare, catch it, and eat it. All based on its eyes and its patience. Pretty cool thing, I think. Mm-hmm. So I guess before we jump into the history part, which is, this is actually pretty quick here, there are other kind of biological or other natural history questions related to this. We can have more questions at the end too, so, yeah.
I really don't know anything about lynx. Is it a family unit? I mean, there's a mother somewhere with pups. Is this lynx doing this 58-mile loop and bringing food back to the mother? How does that work?
That's a good question. And I think that I'm probably going to answer that in a little bit. But a little precursor is that, yeah, the kittens actually stay with their mother through the first year of their life. And they disperse out of their mother's home range just at the onset of parturition, like just when they're about ready to give birth to the second litter. the next generation. So in a female home range, you generally will always have a family group, not the male. The male may check in from time to time. They do overlap. Female home ranges overlap with male home ranges. And there is, with the female, a great amount of maternal care, especially in those early months when the animals are still not able to get around on their own. So the female will bring food back to them and, you know, maintain their or her home range. That home range is really the area she needs with the resources for her to raise successful litters. And she's maintaining that, yeah.
What's the lifespan of the lynx and compared to the bobcat?
Well, you know,
how many litters do they have in the females have, and what are their sizes?
You know, I can't answer perfectly or with perfect confidence, but bobcats generally are going to live around 10 years or so, plus or minus. And I have to believe that lynx are similar to that, and they will become sexually mature at the first year, but they don't generally always reproduce that first year. It's the second year where they produce their first litter or their successful litter, if that makes sense. And I don't know specifically how long lynx live in the wild. I probably have read it, but I don't retain things all the time. I have to imagine it's similar to a bobcat.
Litter size, how many litters?
Six when there's good numbers of hair and zero when there's no hair numbers. On average, you're looking at 3.5-4 kittens. Yeah. So this is a picture, one of the first records in modern days of lynx in Vermont. This was taken by a New Hampshire wildlife biologist, bobcat hunter in the Victory Basin of the Northeast Kingdom. And we're going to look at a map in a minute to put that on the map. But this was very exciting. This is like, hey, that's a lynx, and it clearly is. And again, you can see that heel starting to drop down. You can see the lack of distinct, you know, the sharpness of the pads. It's the fur and the size and all of it.
Is that real stats, Ann?
You got it. Yeah.
I mentioned that because the stats came from here. Some of these people.
Oh yeah. Actually, that's right. I did know that.
Know that thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, stats. He lives in Granby, and he spends all his time in the Northeast Kingdom. He's an incredible outdoors person, and he's been a real boon for us with collecting data, just in his outings, just doing what he does. And hey, I saw marten tracks here and lynx tracks here. It's been great. Very knowledgeable outdoors person. So, what do we know about lynx in Vermont? Well, sadly, we don't know a lot. I think when you look at the records, I think it's safe to say they have a very spotty history. Zadok Thompson, who is one of Vermont's earliest historians, I'm not sure that they're much earlier. There's another one whose name I forget from the 1700s. But he did note that they were here, and he noted that when the country was new, it was frequently seen. But the way that this is worded leads you to believe that they were never greatly multiplied in Vermont. And I think that's true. When you look at the history of records of their occurrence, it's pretty sparse. So here's something important to note here. These are bounty records. And yes, every predator in the state of Vermont, across all probably of New England, was a bountied animal at one point in its history. And lynx were no exception. The complication is that people didn't often record lynx or bobcat. It was recorded as wildcat or bay lynx, and there's a lot of issues with trying to separate out the lynx from the regular bobcat bounty records. But suffice it to say, there are thousands upon thousands of records of, you know, mountain lions and wolves and bobcats, and there are only four that are clearly lynx. And I have to believe that if they were more prevalent during this era, that they would have had a more distinct listing in the bounty records, and they would have, you know, you'd see the evidence. Pretty thin. Again, giving testimony to the fact that we are on their southern fringe of their habitat, their range, and we probably always have been. So despite the fact that they are, you know, have never been greatly multiplied here, and that the history is spotty, they were listed as endangered in the state of Vermont in 1972, which is exciting. I think that's a good move for an animal that exists just to our north that has the opportunity to foray into our state. It's a deserved listing, if that makes sense. In 2000, they were federally listed, and I'm going to spend a minute on this so that people understand what this means. So this is the Endangered Species Act, and there are multiple categories of listing in the Endangered Species Act, threatened being one of them. It's not an endangered species. Across their core range, across the boreal forest, they are numerous. In fact, there are hunting and trapping seasons for them. In fact, that pelt that was passed around came from the boreal forests of Canada. It's not endangered, but the key thing to understand is that where they exist in the United States is right on the fringe of their southern range. And that's where change happens often for these species, right? That's where they are butting up against all those issues. Their habitat isn't quite as good. The weather may not be quite right. I mean, this is an animal that is clearly an animal of the north. Its pelt, the fur, the legs, the feet, everything about it speaks north, deep snow. And so the further south it goes, it gets into less and less suitable conditions. It's also competing with the whole host of other more southern carnivores, the bobcat, the coyote, you know, fisher, for example. And so at that edge is where change happens most often. So that's why they are listed as threatened in the United States, is to protect that edge, to maintain that edge. And when you look at the listing, this is actually excerpted right from the 2000 Endangered Species Act listing. It identified where it was listed. And interestingly, it shows them on the Green Mountain spine.
Yeah.
And up to this year, we haven't really ever documented them anywhere near the spine. I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit, but there are three distinctions of habitat that is listed when an animal is put on the threatened list. There's core habitat, there's secondary habitat, and then there's peripheral habitat. And here in Vermont and in the Adirondacks, these are peripheral habitats, and this is the definition which I think is very apt. In peripheral areas, the majority of historical lynx records are sporadic and generally correspond to periods following cyclic lynx population highs in Canada. There is no evidence of long-term presence or reproduction that might indicate colonization or sustained use of these areas by lynx, and that's really what we had. So it was an apt designation. When an animal is listed, it frees up a lot of money for study. Well, yeah, if it's listed for any reason, you need to put some resources there to try to keep it healthy and persisting. And so one of the first things that is done with those resources is to try to understand its distribution. And so right around 2000, when it was being considered for listing, and then subsequent to 2000 when it was actually listed, there were a number of people that did what we call modeled presence, absence, or habitat suitability models, occupancy models, trying to get a feel of where these animals might exist. And this is one that was done a little bit later in 2012, and I chose it over several others only because they all look very similar. But this one really showed a couple of land features that stand out. The white here, interestingly, that's the better quality habitat. The black is the lowest quality, the least likely to be occupied by lynx. So if you look right there, that round spot is the Mohegan Basin, which is largely the Conti Refuge, the Silvio Conti Refuge in northeastern Vermont. And a little bit south of it is another blob of good quality habitat, contiguous, unbroken habitat. That's the Victory Basin. I suspect that some of you probably have been up there birding. Is that true? Yeah? It's fabulous birding up there because it's sort of a boreal forest. And so you have species there that aren't going to exist anywhere else in the state. The spine of the Green Mountains on any of the models that I have seen never rates as high as those two spots there, this kind of northeast corner. It's more spotty. It's interspersed with lower quality habitats, roads, and such. So beginning, oddly enough, right around the time that it was being considered for listing, and then after it was listed, we started getting sightings. And it's important to understand that sightings aren't always actually what the people think it is. So you have to wade through this. And when I show you the map, you'll see what I mean. So the red is confirmed sightings. That means there is actually physical evidence provided. Photos, tracks. This is the biologist that we talked about in the Victory Basin. This is a little bit out of date. I had intended to update this for the presentation. This was done, I think, in 2015. And now we've got somewhere in the ballpark of around 70 sightings, and we're pushing somewhere around 15 confirmed sightings. And this summer, we had a confirmed sighting, very exciting, here in Londonderry, Vermont, Searsburg, Vermont, drumroll, Aalborg, which is, if anyone knows Aalborg, it is not lynx habitat. We have, staying with the Aalborg one, and that was a video taken by a bow hunter up in the tree stand, and very clear. We had a warden go verify the location, absolutely. We look at Google Maps of where this lynx occurred in Aalborg. It's a small block of forest surrounded by a sea of ag land, and I'll tell you, lynx don't like ag land. They're not open land animals. And then interestingly, we had sightings after that in Swanton and in Highgate, not confirmed because there was no physical evidence that we could confirm it by. But when you look at the overview of the area from like Google Maps or whatever, you could actually pick out the path that that animal almost certainly had to walk to get through that gauntlet of ag land up there. So the point is, though, that you do have a concentration here of confirmed sightings, and that makes sense. That's where the habitat is. And a few additional sightings to boot. So we're wondering, like, why is it all of a sudden that we're getting these sightings? I find this to be the most fascinating part of lynx history, of certainly modern day history here in Vermont. These are study animals in Maine, part of the study we just talked about, and no, lynx don't walk straight lines, but these are just representations of, you know, the center of the study area. These are the furthest dispersers that they documented. This one here was, I believe, a female with kittens and came back. Don't quote me on that, I'm pretty sure of that. But this is essentially 250 miles. And if you were to sweep that around, we're down here into Vermont. Actually, many of these, well, get a 250-mile dispersal, any of those really could be coming to Vermont. So what's going on? We, up to this point, we figured that this was all about dispersers. And so again, when hair numbers start to decline, that's what they do. They disperse, and they will disperse long distance. And there's a little bit about Northern Maine history that is key to this. So I grew up not too far from this area and spent a lot of time up there in my youth. And in the 70s, there was a major spruce budworm infestation up there. And that's an insect that kills spruce and fir trees. And it killed off millions of acres of industrial forest land. Millions. I remember going there into Baxter State Park, and there were raging wildfires because all the standing dead, you know, spruce and fir. The log trucks up there, they were harvesting as fast as they could just to salvage. This is private land, industrial forest land. So they were logging as fast as they could to capture their revenue from those forests before they died and burnt or what have you. the end result was there was millions of acres of clear cut. I remember we went to the Allegash region on one canoe trip when I was probably a freshman in high school or something, maybe a little younger than that even, but I remember from the Allegash in a couple of different places, you could see out and there was nothing but clear cut in any direction. Oops. So what happens is that regenerates, and it regenerates to spruce fir forest, and that is exactly what snowshoe hare like, that early successional spruce fir forest. They thrive in it. And so in the 70s, we had the habitat disruption that set the stage for absolutely ideal snowshoe hare conditions into the 80s and even into the 90s. And then what happens? The lynx population takes advantage of that. The lynx population skyrocketed, the highest they think that it ever was. And then just like that cycle we saw on the graph, its peak and started to come down. And they figure that started to happen right around 2000. I mean, it's not a sharp date, obviously, but it's, generally started to go downhill around that time. And that's when these animals started dispersing out. And that's coincidentally when we start seeing them here in Vermont. I find that fascinating. I love landscape ecology stuff. So that was the general consensus, right? These are dispersers. They're going to probably disappear. And then in 2010, a young snowmobiler in the Nelhegan Basin, again, that's the Conti Refuge, that block, the biggest block of contiguous habitat, happened along this. Can you imagine? It makes me so mad. It's just really an awesome picture. And the key here is that this is February. And if you recall me saying earlier that they are solitary animals, the only time where you're going to find them grouped together, other than the family unit of a female and her kittens, is when there's mating going on, or these even could be kittens. There may be other animals here, we don't know. They don't always stay like close together, as I learned later while doing my surveys up there. But without a doubt, this is pretty clearly a confirmation that at least the potential for reproduction was there. There's two apparently adult animals, although that's hard to tell in February because even kittens would be pretty much full grown there. So that was a game changer for us. We're like, okay, well that really changes the stage of what we need to up the ante here with respect to conservation efforts, right? They're here. They may be resident, they may be reproducing. We don't know a lot about them, but there are things we need to do. And the first thing that we did was we engaged the VTA, that's the Vermont Trappers Association, to make sure that trappers in that region, in particular, that region, knew, and they knew already, because they're the ones that were providing us with the information a lot of times. Well, I saw lynx tracks there. But we had to engage them in the conversation about making sure that these cats, these lynx, don't end up in traps that were set for other species, particularly body gripping traps, which is a kill type trap. We don't want that. And I will say, and I say it very proudly, that the Vermont Trappers Association stepped to that table wholeheartedly. We had a unanimous vote for a sweeping change of trapping rules in the Northeast Kingdom that was really hard for some of these guys to stomach who've been trapping up there for decades. Unanimous vote at the VTA board to support the rules, and then we took that to the Fish and Wildlife Board and we got another unanimous vote for that, which is hard to get a unanimous vote for anything out of either of those two entities. Trust me. But we did. And we changed the rules and we set off a study period, a 10-year study period. So this began in 2012 is when the rules went into place. I think it was 2012 when they finally went into place. And it set a 10-year study period. And we said, these are the rules for this 10-year period. And during that period, we're going to study lynx to the best of our ability to do so. And at the end of the 10 years, we're going to revisit the rules. And we're going to apply what we've learned. And we're going to base our new rules on three things. That would be the outcome of the process that Maine was going through simultaneously with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service with respect to an incidental take permit for their trapping program, because they were trapping animals. But again, it's a different scenario. There are hundreds of lynx, and across that northern tier, there are hundreds of trappers. And so the opportunity was much greater there. So they had to get an incidental take permit, and that's a long process, very legal, very political, very complicated. And so we said, well, we're going to watch that for the next 10 years and see at the outset what the outcome was, and we'll consider adopting those rules at that point. The other things were, we will base our rules on our knowledge of where these animals exist in the state and their current status. Are they abundant? Are they, you know, disappearing? What have you? And the third, and importantly, was if in the interim, were there new trapping techniques that were devised that would further ensure keeping these animals out? So the rules that we have do their job. They keep these animals to the best of our ability out of these traps, but we are hoping that at the end of the 10 years, we'll have better information on all regard, in all respects, to implement real solid rules there, whatever that might be. I don't mean to harp on that too much, but it's important because this is something that you will hear about. It will be in the news. It wasn't in the news back then here in Vermont that much, but I guarantee you in 2022, it will be in the news when we revisit these things. Also around that same time, you know, the trapping stuff aside, we also began actively trying to monitor and figure out methods of documenting their, this is part of the 10-year study. So using the methodology that was tested in Maine during that study that I even talked about a little bit, where we had the technicians going around on snowmobiles looking for track intercepts, and because we had study animals where we knew where they crossed, so we could test that methodology. And they found that if you did X amount of distance of survey transect, you would definitively find your lynx. You could document not necessarily how many, but you would document presence, which is all we were looking for. And so we started right in the core of that habitat, that biggest, most beautiful part of lynx habitat in Vermont, the Mount Egan Basin, and we worked with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and we conducted just that, a snow track survey. So the purple lines are actually snowmobile trails. The yellow lines are logging roads, which are closed to snowmobile traffic, but we snowmobiled them. We did a bunch of snowshoeing, so on and so forth. And it's probably hard to pick this out. There's a lot of data there. Whoops. Yeah, a lot of data there, which is probably not all that important. The key here is that, it's actually funny, I had WCAX in tow. So to get out here is quite a process just to get into the refuge in the wintertime. So we had multiple snowmobiles, multiple technicians. I was an absolute wreck for weeks going into this in panic mode. WCAX is going to be there recording the whole event, right? We get out there, one of the snowmobiles rolled over with the WCAX camera guy on it. A little bit of a fiasco, but it was good, no one was hurt. We got in, it's cold, we're doing our snow track survey, and I didn't think we'd find anything, honestly. I was like, well, you know, we're not going to find anything. They got their video, and they said, well, just call us if you find anything, we're going to go back. So shuttled them back. I get back to the refuge headquarters with the WCAX folks, and I could still see the taillights of their van driving away when the radio rang and says, I think we've got lynx tracks. I'm like, oh, really? Okay. So I found my way to their GPS coordinates, and not only did we find a lynx track, we found three in one spot running down the trail together. So again, that was clear. If there was ever a doubt in 2010 with Michael Bancroft's photo, not anymore. There's reproduction here. That was 2012. And based on the survey results and the locations of the lynx that we intercepted in that event, we figured there was at least five individual lynx in the refuge during that period. I think there's possibly even six, but that's hard to say definitively. And we documented four individuals via DNA collecting scat. That was my job. I was the scat collector. And that's okay. I'm okay with collecting scat. That's not too bad. Somebody has to do it. You're absolutely right. So in 2013, we moved down to the Victory Basin. We were feeling satisfied. We documented reproduction in the Malheagan. Let's move the two, I think it's like 30 kilometers south, perhaps. So it's just a day's walk for a lynx to get from the Malheagan Basin into the Victory Basin. So it's excellent habitat. It is a hare haven up there. So we figured we're going to, I was all jazzed, we're going to find him up there. And we did the same method, using mostly Vermont Fish and Wildlife staff, some U.S. Fish and Wildlife staff, and there are a number of volunteer trappers that helped out on it too, because they know these areas well. And I can rely on them for track identifications as well. And we spread out, and I spot checked everybody. That was my job. I thought I'd be collecting scats again, but I didn't get any. We didn't pick up any there in Victory. That was a real head scratcher. It took me a while to figure it out. We interestingly got Fisher everywhere. Fisher tracks, coyote tracks, bobcat tracks, and I point at Fisher because that's a key point that will be coming up here. In 2014, we said, all right, we're going to go back to Victory, back to the Malheagan, and we're going to go to Victory again, but we were experiencing some troubles with our snow in the winter, right? We don't get the snows that we used to, and a snow track survey really depends on snow. And so that hampered some of our efforts the previous 2 years. It made it more complex with timing and trying to get out there and yada yada. So we partnered with the Northeast Climate Science Center, which is affiliated with UMass, a particular researcher, Alex A. Siren, to develop a technique that utilized game cameras, the ubiquitous game camera. And again, our method heretofore was the snow track survey, which was based on research in Maine. And then we did this research where we compared our camera data to the snow track data. And essentially, it was the same. In fact, in 2014, we only documented one lynx in the Malheagan Basin, and it was done with a camera. And we didn't pick any up on snow track survey. So they're actually, those are low numbers. I can't put confidence intervals around any of this. But it would indicate that the cameras did pretty well. And in New Hampshire, they were doing the same exact study. And they actually had higher numbers that we could lean on and say definitively the camera-based methodology detects lynx if you put them at such and such a density and so on and so forth. 2015, we repeated this survey. The green spots are the cameras, the blue lines, and I think they're all blue, maybe red and black up above. Those are the transects. 2015, we did the same thing, but then we didn't get any lynx anywhere. And I have to tell you, based on my experience up there, that if there was a lynx, whoops, darn it, if there was a lynx anywhere in that area, we would have picked it up. It's unquestionable. So we start scratching our head. Well, why? Well, you could lean on the fact that, you know, this is peripheral habitat. This is the history of the animal in the area. Even the Malheagan Basin itself being beautiful habitat and the Victory Basin being smaller but equally as nice, they're not terribly big areas. We're not really sure, but we'll go through a list of some of the theories and some of the evidence that we've collected in the last 4 or 5 years now that I think kind of gets at this. Are there questions about anything before we jump into it? I'm almost done, which is good. Yeah?
What kind of practices did you change in terms of trapping to avoid having them be trapped? You said there were preliminary changes. What kind of
Well, they're preliminary, but they are not ones that we devised necessarily on our own. So these were emulated from Maine. The rules that we adopted. Actually, we adopted rules from Minnesota, we adopted rules from Maine, and we implemented our own rules. So it was a mixture of all of it. And at the end of the day, we felt like we've done due diligence in that respect. Again, we still have a few years left, or 5 years left for our study period. But to answer your question specifically, again, the trap that is particularly of concern here is a kill-type trap. And you don't want a lynx in one of those. And so we spent a lot of time dealing with that. And so we adopted exclusion devices, which is like a cage that you put that trap in that keeps the lynx can't get in, but the target animal, typically the fisher, that's the set that's of most concern, is a fisher set, can. And we require that they be off the ground, so certain kill type traps of a certain size have to be 5 feet off the ground. In Maine, they're 4 feet off the ground, so we said, well, let me give it an extra foot. The rule we adopted, there are a couple of rules we adopted from Minnesota. One of them was called a bucket set, where the trap has, it's a 5 gallon bucket, the trap has to be set a certain distance back in, and then the lid is snapped on, and then a hole cut in the lid that's of a certain size that would prohibit a lynx from getting in there. Is it perfect? Probably not. And some evidence in Maine would suggest that, yeah, it's probably not perfect. But it certainly, in our situation in Vermont, where we have a much, much lower density of lynx, as we are learning, and much fewer trappers, I felt like it's we've done our due diligence to absolutely minimize that likelihood. And again, we are collecting more information as we go on. Does that answer your question? So, I hate ending on the obstacles of lynx conservation, but this really is the crux of it. And this is a key group, because I think everyone here has something to contribute to lynx conservation. Not necessarily in all bullets, but on a few key ones. So one of the things that I think is a key issue for lynx here in Vermont, and I'm going to spend a minute on this one because this is not only interesting, but it's important to understand, is that these animals are competing with sympatric carnivores. That means other animals that exist at the same scale, at the same geographic scale, the same landscape, sympatric. Particularly fisher, and we don't think of fisher, I'm like, why would fisher bother lynx? In Maine, going back to their research up there, again, they had, I think it was 80 to 90, I think it's actually 83 study animals collared. These are GPS collars, and when those collars stop moving for a length of time, it triggers a signal that the biologist can hear, and then they know that that animal has not been moving, and so likely is dead, or something's gone wrong, maybe the collar fell off or whatever. So they send in a technician to the coordinates, and they get the evidence. And this is a listed species, so any of these events are law enforcement quality. There's evidence. So 18 animals during that duration were definitively killed. These are adult lynx. They don't put collars on kittens. So 18 of these study animals were killed by predators, which is, to me, fascinating in itself. If you look at the ratio there, I think it's 83 study animals and 18 died of predation. 14 of those 18 were killed by fisher. And so the evidence that they lean on there is what they call pre-mortem wounds. Is that correct? It's post-mortem and pre-mortem. Pre-mortem, those are the wounds that killed the animal. Post-mortem, it could be any scavenger that's come along afterward and chose to make a meal or what have you. So all these animals, all the possible predators, have distinct bite patterns. They also leave sign at the site, right? There's tracks, there's scat, so there's a investigation when you have a dead lynx, particularly a study animal. They go and they find there's fisher tracks all over, and they haul the carcass off, and they do necropsies on it. So when they say 14 were killed by fisher, they're killed by fisher. Interestingly, there were 9 other, beyond the 18 that were killed by predators, definitively. I'll back up. The other 4, I think, were coyote. Then there were 9 others that were definitively killed by predators, but they could not, through pre-mortem wound investigation, because of the condition of the carcass, they could not definitively tell what species killed it, but they suspect, based on sign at the site, that those were fisher, all 9. Now, I don't know if that's true, but I'm sure a portion of them were. So I'm going to step back now into Victory Basin, where we've not yet definitively documented them. We had the biologist from New Hampshire who has provided us, and some trappers actually since have provided us track evidence, but they're not there. They're not resident, they're not reproducing there. And so in 2012, during the fisher trapping season. Fisher trapping season in Vermont is the month of December, the whole month. So in the Township of Victory, trappers harvested 16 fisher out of the Township of Victory in the month of December 2012. 2013, January, February, March, the 3 months we did multiple track surveys out there. Our crews documented fisher as being the most common species intercepted on the track surveys within 3 months of having 16 of them removed from that township. And this is all on public land that we're doing our work on, and that's where trappers are going too, because they have access there. So the point here is that there is a robust population of competitors that these animals have to contend with. And I think that in itself is probably a limiting factor and probably always will be because of the position that we're at on their range. And I don't want to paint an ugly picture. That's ecology. That's what it is. And it's still interesting and fascinating. But it is one of the considerations that we need to measure when we talk about lynx conservation through the future. We have to consider this. This I've kind of talked about already. I don't want to beat it up too much, but there's just simply not a lot of suitable habitat in the state of Vermont. And when you look at, this is Laura Farrell's habitat model. It's a habitat suitability model. The blue is the best quality habitat, down to the brown, I guess it is, or orange, that's the lowest quality habitat. Here's the Nahuatl Basin, and here's the Victory Basin, and look where the confirmed sightings of the red dots, that's where they are, right? That's not a lot of habitat, particularly when you start putting home range sizes over that. So the smaller polygon, the smallest circle there is 24 square miles, that's the smallest estimate of male home range size. And the bigger one's 58, that's the larger one. That's in the core of their habitat. In Vermont, the southern edge, we're looking at possibly as much as 80 square miles to sustain them. So even if you were to like fully occupy this whole area here, you're not talking a lot of animals, and that in itself will always be a conservation issue. And it also demonstrates that we need to be very careful about our habitat, because it's not plentiful. And this is where people come into play, right? This is where we can all make a difference. You know, loss of suitable habitat loss is perhaps one of the biggest issues for the species in the state. Fortunately, here in the Northeast Kingdom, we're in pretty good shape. We're doing due diligence up there. This is the Nahuatl Refuge, the Conti Refuge, it's federal. The yellow is all now owned by Weyerhaeuser, but it's all conserved by Vermont Land Trust easements, which will keep it a working forest, which snowshoe hare are like working forests. The green here is West Mountain Wildlife Management Area, owned by Vermont Fish and Wildlife. That's the Victory Basin Wildlife Management Area, Fish and Wildlife, Bill Slattic. These are forests and parks lands. The point is that we have a lot of conserved land up there. And that's awesome. I'm not suggesting that we should end that. We need to continue that, because habitat is the key here. It's those are the landscape issues that we have to deal with if you want to seriously consider lynx conservation through the future. There's a lot that I could say about that. I actually think the Audubon Society was involved. Much of this land here was purchased during the Champion Lands deals back in 2000, I think. Very controversial. Everyone pulled, the stocks were all pulled, right? So the Nature Conservancy, Vermont Land Trust, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, there's a long list of contributors to this effort, and bought the land, parceled it up, and put it into public easements, public ownership. Really an incredible thing, and those are the sort of things that we need to look at through the future, not for just lynx, but for all of our species, really. I just heard recently that Bird Mountain, just a little bit south of us, I think that's almost final, if not final. It's 3,000 acres of conserved land in one contiguous block. Do you know if that's the finalized? I don't want to misspeak, but I thought that it was finalized, which is a fabulous win for conservation for wildlife. There's no doubt about it. So incidental take, we talked a little bit about the rules, our study period, the 10 years, what's happening in Maine, but it's also important to note that it's not just trapping. And people will focus on that, that's what you're gonna hear about for a whole host of other reasons. But from 2010 to 2011 in Maine, they had five animals that were, there were five animals that were lynx, we're talking about, five animals that were shot, totally illegal, no excuses there. They had five animals that were trapped, and they had 27 animals that were hit by cars, to put it into perspective. I know the 27 and the five and the five, I'm not sure if it was five hunted or if those were, it doesn't matter, but those are the rough numbers there, and that's stark. In the Nauhegan Basin, it's got it's not a super highway by any stretch, it's Route 105, but for those who've ever driven Route 105 through the Nauhegan Basin, there's some high volume traffic at times, and there are big trucks moving along. I mean, there's an issue for lynx conservation. And there's more issues. It's not just, you know, vehicles and trapping. We'll leave it at that. You get the point. And this one here is actually excerpted from the recovery outline. I know that's a lot to read, and I don't expect you to, but it's basically the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service recovery outline for Canada Lynx. Really leans on climate change. Anything, if climate change manifests itself with reduced snow depths, this animal of the north does not fare well here. It's just the bottom line. And so this is, again, something that people can make a difference on. And I don't think we need to harp on it. We all understand that. But that's key. Because it's not just the loss of snow. It's the shifting of the ecology of the landscape. It's the shifting of the forest. It's the shifting of the St. Patrick carnivores that exist there. It's the whole thing. So, it's happening slowly. We don't see it that often. We don't see it that rapidly. But if it does happen to the point where it manifests itself in a changed landscape, it will not benefit lynx. So where do we go from here? Well, I'm glad I got that response after that low. Bring it back up. This is all, all self-explanatory. We need to continue our work to monitor, and we're doing that actually this year with the lynx that was confirmed in Londonderry, Vermont, and then in Searsburg, Vermont. We engaged the U.S. Forest Service, Green Mountain National Forest. We have over 30 cameras out right now throughout the southern Green Mountains in a grid, just like those grids you saw in the Victory and Nauhegan Basin. It's an 8-kilometer grid. The ones in the Victory and Nauhegan Basin were smaller grids, but the point is that we are actively out there looking for these animals to monitor their existence, because without knowing where they are, you can't develop solid conservation strategies, effective conservation strategies. And we'll be moving to the northern unit of the Green Mountain National Forest probably next year and expanding our efforts there. We need to say begin monitoring hare populations is a little bit of a misnomer. Well, we do monitor hare populations, but we need to ramp that up because they are such a keystone species, particularly for lynx. And one of our partners, again, Alex A. Siren at the Northeast Climate Science Center, has kicked off a radio telemetry study of snowshoe hares in the Nauhegan Basin as well as in northern New Hampshire. And part of that, hopefully one of the outcomes of that is a better understanding of the dynamics of snowshoe hare demography in that region. And then therefore we can maybe move forward with some well-informed land management practices, some conservation strategies that benefit lynx and hopefully, or benefit snowshoe hare and hopefully lynx. Incidental take, that is never going to go away. We're going to have to continue to evolve with that and address that. But of all the list, this is something that I think that we have action items there that we can work on there that's definitive, which I like. That's something that we can do. Habitat conservation, not only advocating for it, but supporting it and doing it. Very important. And habitat management, that whole swath of the Northeast Kingdom, it's all conserved land. Well, we have an opportunity to manage that And you don't want to get into the scenario of managing for a single species, but we need to manage it for the whole host of species that rely on those habitats, including lynx, and a whole host of the birds, and so on and so forth. And then managing some Patrick carnivores, again, that is part of this equation. If lynx conservation, if you want to have a persistent population here, that's something that we need to consider, what we do. And last but not least, climate change. That's a tough one, but that's real. So there you have it. I'll take questions or, yeah.
Could you give us a summary of the cousin, the bobcat, and what its numbers are doing and how it's, it seems like you're seeing more and more of them.
Bobcats?
Yeah.
Absolutely. I will tell you that they are an abundant species throughout the state. There's really not a part of the state where they don't exist. I will tell you something I learned recently that you might find interesting with respect to bobcats. So in Vermont, any hunter or trapper that harvests one of these animals, bobcats, has by law to turn in the carcass once they've removed the pelt or whatever they want from the animal, glands, meat, what have you. So we get what's left, the carcass. And that's become a boon for researchers. We have at these necropsy sessions where we, not dissecting per se, but we're gathering our data. So sex, age, physical condition, that's the data that we use for managing and monitoring the population. But then we have these researchers coming from UVM, from Green Mountain College, Castleton, Linden, UNH. This is the one I've had people from Pennsylvania. We had someone from Georgia come up just specifically because of the opportunity to collect tissue for research. So we had a researcher from New Hampshire the last few years. He's coming again this year, by the name of Rory Carroll. Great guy. He's a PhD student working under, I think it's John Vitus. And so he's doing a variety of things, but partly genetics, one of the focus areas. And so he has definitively determined that New Hampshire is a net exporter of bobcats. And at the same time, I'm like looking at data, my bobcat data, and in the Connecticut River Valley, we've seen a shift of the sex ratio in the harvest. So it should be right around 50-50, right? That's what they are in the landscape. Your harvest should be, it's usually swayed a little bit higher to males because they're more trap prone. But at any rate, the female percentage kept getting lower and lower and lower. I'm like, what is going on here? That's alarming. And then I had the conversation with Roy Carroll at UNH, and he's like, yeah, we're exporting bobcats, because he's looking at our genetics compared to his genetics, and it's clearly demonstrating that there's some influence there. And it dawned on me at that moment, I'm like, well, that's what's happening in the Connecticut River Valley, because the dispersers are the males. And so we have lots of males coming across the river into the Connecticut River Valley primarily, but certainly they're filtering up into the hills, and it's actually affecting, and I don't think necessarily in a bad way, I'm not painting a gloom and doom here, but it's actually affecting the sex ratio in the landscape. But to give it your specific question, they are abundant throughout the state. I don't have a finite number, because to do that, to actually get a finite number, there is, you know, 8,000 bobcats statewide. That's a really tough thing to get at. It takes a lot of resources to do that, and then we still have confidence intervals on that, and then you have to do it repetitively in order to have it mean something as far as what the population is doing over time. And I contend, and I think righteously, that they are fine based on all the indexes that we have. Those resources that would otherwise be spent trying to get a better estimate should be spent on these species that we know are at risk. And that's exactly what we do. I think it's better than 50% of our wildlife division budget goes into land conservation and management. And that's where it should be, because that's the underlying thing. Yeah.
I was wondering if the fisher population is higher than is equitable.
Higher than equitable.
What I mean is, have we got too many fishers so they're being too hard on everybody else?
No, and I don't want to paint Fisher as being a demon here, because they are equally...
Is it up or is it down?
It's cyclical. So you have, for example, there's many things that influence Fisher population over time. But for example, you have a beech nut crop one year. I mean, a significant, we had one, I think, 2 years ago where it was just incredible beech nut production. That impacts or benefits the small mammal population tremendously. Mice, rodents of all types, squirrels, they go through the roof, and then the fisher takes advantage of or they'll actually take advantage of the nuts themselves. But then after a period of time, when the nuts are long gone, they're taking advantage of the rodents that they produced. And so we'll have a spike up in the population. And when that happens, other things do drop down. The porcupine population, if you're seeing lots of porcupine, you probably don't have a lot of fisher in your neighborhood. If you are seeing no porcupine, then your fisher population is pretty high. I mean, that's, we're talking in general, but that's, they focus on porcupines large, you know, as one of many prey items, but you'll note that relationship, yeah.
But adding to that question, why would the fisher then be targeting the lynx?
They are a top predator, you know, and they're an animal of opportunity, an animal of their stomach. And if they have an opportunity, they're going to...
The size of the... How big is the fisher?
A male might be, I think, on the greater end of things, 12, 15 pounds. Like on average, you're looking at 10 pounds.
Size of...
Yep.
Half.
They're all tooth and claw, though.
So if you drew a picture of the fisher in front of that,
it would be
tall.
Considerably shorter.
Yeah.
They're not a tall animal. They would be... A little bit, of, including the tail, not too dissimilar in length, maybe a little shorter in length, but they're all muscle.
So they're okay.
Yeah. Jim.
So who's the big predator of the fisher? I mean, what is it? What is the cycles of fishers? Is it?
I have never heard of any. Well, yeah. I mean, again, speaking in general terms. I don't think that there is one specific predator that we can point to and say that's an effective predator of fisher. There are, I mean, even a coyote, or even a bobcat, or owl, some bird of prey can certainly take a fisher, but I'll tell you what, they're putting themselves at risk to do that. But that we've documented that before, you know, owls in particular. But I don't think that they're controlling the fisher population. I think it's a matter of opportunity. I think it's more of the prey. That's keeping that cycle going, yeah.
Do the fisher have the same impact on the bobcats as they do?
They have one of these relationships where you will find there's actually a partitioning of most of the habitats. You're here in the Champlain Valley, this is a stronghold of bobcats, undoubtedly. You are hard put to find a fisher. They're here, but you're hard put to find a fisher here. Is it habitat-driven that's causing the partitioning, or is it some of the interactions between the two? It's probably a combination of both. I would contend it's probably more habitat-related than anything. Fisher is definitively a forest animal. Bobcat, yes, they're a forest animal, but they can make do in a little bit more open landscape using hedgerows and stream corridors and stuff. But there's definitely evidence to suggest that fisher can limit bobcats in habitat types that would allow that to happen. Yeah. And so I've heard trappers in particular say the other way, that sometimes bobcats will actually limit fisher. So it's not a clear answer there. But, yeah.
You're talking about the sex ratio of animals you're seeing in the Connecticut River Basin migrating. If there's an increase in the New Hampshire population, they're dispersing. Why do you see more males in areas of dispersion?
Males are the dispersers. So females generally.
What happens to the females?
The females just occupy, again with bobcats, I'm talking about, not lynx. So females will occupy partly their natal home range. So they'll settle and overlap their mother home range, but then minimally adjacent available terrain. They don't disperse out, again, in general terms. So the females tend to stay closer, nearby. The males are the ones that go the distance and try to establish satellite populations or, you know, distant home ranges. So I have no reason to doubt that there aren't females also coming in, but just not at the same numbers of males.
Okay.
if that makes sense. Yeah. Yeah.
You talked about predating on snowshoe hares. Why not other animals, turkeys?
Are they lynx?
Yeah.
Well, there's no turkeys across their core habitat, and probably have never been. Turkeys are not a northern bird.
Huh? Grouse.
There's no doubt that they will prey switch when hare are low, but they are adept at snowshoe hare. That's what they have evolved to take. They are specialists, a dietary specialist. When hare are plentiful, they're talking 100% of their diet is hare. When hare start to drop off, minimally they're down to like 60% of their diet. The other 40% is made up of whatever other small mammals, but if it doesn't get lower than 60% because they just move on or perish. You know what I mean?
So the bobcat's got much more diverse.
Absolutely. The bobcat is a diet generalist. I mean, it's an animal of opportunity. They have benefited by turkeys, and there's been a preponderance of turkeys, mm-hmm. and reintroduced and trapped and relocated around the state, and it's pretty much statewide turkey population now. In some places, very dense populations of turkeys. And the bobcat has been an absolute benefactor of that, undoubtedly. In fact, turkey hunters, my office mate, Mary Beth, right? She was turkey hunting this spring and had a bobcat come in and thinking that her decoy was real, and it came in stalking it, and she's like, I don't want to be the full bird biologist gets attacked by a bobcat. But you know, they are very keen on turkeys as well as anything, but they're a generalist. Yeah.
Last question.
Sure. Well, there's two people. We'll use two, and we'll be done.
Yeah. I was going to say, the rabbit population is huge now. We see them every day, everywhere.
Yeah.
Do the bobcats take those just as readily?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. They're like rabbits, no doubt about it. Yeah. Any other question?
Me?
Chris, yes.
Animals coming from New Hampshire into Vermont, are they coming through the river, across the river?
Over ice, when they swim as well. I mean, I think it's probably mostly over ice. Again, that times well with dispersal. So similar to lynx, they're dispersing, the young are dispersing from their natal home range in the winter. And so it's frozen, and across they go. So I guess that's it. We have a timeline. You too.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. If you see a lynx, there is a online reporting form new this year on the Fish and Wildlife webpage. Go to the tab that says, I think it's Get Involved, and then there's a number of reporting forms there, and we have one set up for lynx and mountain lion and American martin, and it's good information. Even if you're not confident that it's a lynx, by all means, take the 5 minutes that it'll take to upload your information. It's good stuff. Thank you all. It's good questions.